Hi, welcome to Polymer Clay Journey. This is in conjunction with my Heartfully Creating blog at heartfullycreating.blogspot.com. The supplies you're going to need for today's tutorial, which is Anita's version of a faux turquoise. I used some for this. Actually, I've done a few variations, four to be exact. I used metallic mostly, peacock, bright green pearl, and the turquoise. And in one variation, I did use the pearl. And you'll need some cookie cutters if you want to make some cabochons, as well as other tools that you want to use for shaping and molding and all of that once you're done. So I basically began marbleizing, twisting, and creating the combination of colors that I wanted. Now I called this, quote, faux turquoise, because it's not true to form. If you look up, it's always good to look up whatever stone you're trying to sort of copy or imitate. True turquoise does not have any shiny elements that I know of. I believe I've heard some people refer to bits of possibly copper. So I did introduce some metallic foils. And so these are all three different ones that you've just seen of different mixtures and variations. Now you can mix and mix and mix until you have a solid color, but I don't like that. I find it kind of boring. So if you look closely, even to the ones that look solid, they're actually not really solid. They still have striations of color. Then I use some rose gold or copper, a more inexpensive art foil that I found not as foil-like, if that makes any sense to you. It was more of a synthetic fiber, it felt like, but it still worked. Now the whole other problem I developed later, I've been putting it on my Instagram and our Heartfully Creating Facebook group about playing around with resining UV resin and putting it on some of my pieces right now. Some of them are remaining sticky, and I'm wondering if it has anything to do with some of the elements that are in the clay. So that's another experiment for another day. I'm just getting a little frustrated as of now when it comes to putting resin on my finished pieces. Too much stickiness. Anywho, back to the topic. So once you get everything incorporated, you chop and chop and chop. You don't want to mix. Now, other people would have different techniques using the metallic foils or using metallic powders, which is what I did. I incorporated both, actually. I also, after I had it marbled enough, mixing my different colors, I didn't use any solid color. Like, I didn't use turquoise from the package. I didn't use bright pearl green from the package. I mean, I did, but you know what I mean? I mixed them together. So none of them are true from the package. I love color mixing, so that's totally up to you. But I found I didn't like any high contrast variation of blues or greens or turquoise. I really do love the bluey green turquoise color. So, like I said, I have four different batches and they all turn out differently on purpose, of course, because I'm experimenting and having fun. If you have something that you want to stay the exact same, then do a really big batch of it so you won't run out. And then when I added the foils, I had chopped it all up, just really rough chopping it, actually as small as you want. Then I dunked or sprinkled, more like dumped, because you can tell by the mess. I'm just adding some rose gold / copper powder. I can't really tell the difference. I know there is a difference, but because I think rose gold is a combination of gold and copper. And then once I did all that and mixed it in with my fingers loosely to keep the chunks formed, because you want to create veins. Basically, that's what you're doing. Then I added some pre-mixed good color Stevenson acrylic, mostly is what I have, for the good acrylic paint, because I find the craft paints just aren't very stable. I don't know. I don't like that they rub off. So I did mix that with another combination of paints that I mix. And I just keep them in the Wilton-type squeeze tubies there that you could use for mustard and ketchup. And then it was great fun. I did use wax paper on the surface and some vinyl gloves. Yeah, it was pretty messy. So picture this. I did the first batch with nothing but a tile, no wax paper, and no gloves, and oh boy, what a mess. It was really, thankfully, acrylic, once it dries, peels off like a plastic film, but it was messy, so it's way better to be coated with something, even though I really miss touching and feeling. To me, making art is all about feeling the materials that you're working with and feeling those textures, so I did miss that. Once I scrunched it up, I chopped through it just to see if I liked how tiny the pieces were, what the veining looks like, or striations, and you just squeeze again. I didn't wait for it to dry, but you could spread it out and let it dry a bit, and then start squeezing them together in little geodes or clumps or whatever. So I did do that. In one batch, I let it dry, but not very much. And one of the things that you want to take note of is when you bunch up the clay into a form or a log or a cane, then the paint inside won't be able to dry. So when you go to cut it and form it into a cabochon or a bead or whatever you're going to do with it, you will end up with wet paint on your hands. So just know that you can always sand it off once it's baked or wipe it off with a baby wipe or alcohol wipe or whatever. Remember, alcohol wipe, alcohol does dissolve the clay, so you don't want to leave it on there. You can just give it a nice quick wipe, though. Baby wipes work wonders. So again, just having lots of fun with, reminds me of being a kid and finger painting. So smushing and squishing, and again, through this video, I have my different batches showing. This one, I won't tell you what it looks like, but you can see the veins. So the darker clays with some of the metallics in there, the metallic foils of gold and some coppers. And I just, yeah, you just sort of break it into there, creating veins. That's however, when you think of creating veins, that means not mixing the clay. You don't want to mix the paint in. You want to coat each piece so that when you push it all together, when you slice into it, you will have the veining that you see in a lot of great turquoise. This was my very first one. It didn't turn out so great. I actually used black clay instead of any paint, so it was pretty limited in the black and not as interesting. This is my favorite so far. I left a lot more green, a lot more striation. I used some copper, not the icky kind, but a better copper foil, art foil that I had. And these are some of the finished pieces with the like just cabochon, pendant type things. The pasta machine is handy to use when forming veneers, which I talked about in the last video, because I did show the veneer, the turquoise veneer, and what I did with them instead of the tutorial for the turquoise. And so I saved it for after because I was too excited to show the finished pieces, which are, here are some of them again. And here's another, quote, cane. I call it a cane because it's something that you form and slice through. But it's kind of like makumagane, where each slice is going to be different, right? Because you've got a bundled up bunch of clay. And again, this is my favorite one, the last one that I did, the last batch. And even though you've got little cracks and layers, I did slice it finely to make a veneer, put it on another rolled out sheet of clay, put it through the pasta machine. And even though some of the pieces still lifted, I just left it that way because then you could either antique it later with some paint, which is going to come hopefully in a future tutorial. And yeah, and then I also made beads with the leftovers, which included some of the backs of the veneer that I used. The color backing might have been gold or black, so that will show up in your scraps. Now for the cabochons, I take the cookie cutters, and you can lay a piece of saran wrap or a heavier plastic and push down, and then you'll get rounded edges. Didn't really work for me, probably because I can't stand up, so I can't push down very hard. So I took this hockey stick tool type thing, and I started forming the edges to bevel the edges. I don't like just straight cut edges. I actually like beveling them. But again, that's another issue if you decide to dome it with UV resin or any kind of resin, because now you can't just run it to the edge because it slopes down, if that makes any sense. So that's something to think about. Again, I have been doing a whole lot of experimenting and it's been a whole lot of fun. And I have been really frustrated that I've been kind of ruining my pieces with the UV resin stage, but more on that later. But I just want you to know how to do the, quote, Anita's version of faux turquoise. So I hope you're inspired to give it a try. And again, you don't have to use turquoise colors because, like I said, it's, quote, faux turquoise. It's not true faux turquoise. It's God created the perfect turquoise. I'm just having fun trying to, you know, I'm inspired by his creation, as I am with a lot of artist creation. But since he's the artist, yeah, I can't copy it. So I just play around and I'm inspired. So I hope you're inspired just a little bit. I would love to hear from you. Please feel free to join our Facebook group, Heartfully Creating. Just look for that on Facebook and Instagram at Abergi Creation. And check out the blog that goes with this, which is, I'm losing it today, Heartfully Creation, Heartfully Creating. www.blogspot.com. So thank you. Have a great day. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like and share and subscribe if you want to.